Very good afternoon. I missed you all last Saturday because we had a very wonderful seminar. We had an open and free seminar for everybody connected with special education. That included people who are running special schools or integrated schools. It included special educators who are practicing on their own. We had many parents who have special children. And we had people who are in the, you know, service of children with special needs. It could be like occupational therapy, speech therapy, all these things. So we got all these people under one platform last Saturday. And we had a wonderful 3 hours with them. So many of them. We also felicitated three of the top level people who have put in wonderful service. Two of them are in their 90s. That is Mr. J.P. Gadkari and Mrs. Rukmini Krishnaswamy. And we also felicitated the first professor and head of department of the Child Psychiatry Department, Dr. Shobha Srinath, who is now retired and is being a wonderful consultant to so many institutions and parents who have children with special needs. So that's why we had to cancel last week's program. And here we are again continuing with our routine. And most probably, unless there is something very, very specific or very urgent, we will continue through this summer time having our Saturday afternoon sessions. And I would invite all of you to not only join us, but also spread the word to your friends who may be interested. During this vacation period, we've got some very nice topics lined up, which Anis will tell you. And you can join us every Saturday at 2 o'clock. And as you know the process, I talk for roughly half an hour, 2 to 2.30, and then close whatever I had to say. And depending on the number of people and the number of comments and questions, we have an open house. So the advantage of being live in this Saturday session is that you can not only clarify your doubts and ask questions, you can also put in your viewpoints, because human behavior and social sciences do not follow specific rules. Everybody would have had some experience which they can share and we get to know. And if by chance you miss out this Saturday 2 o'clock session, it remains. You can log in and listen to it and watch it as whenever you feel like and whenever you are comfortable. So now we come to today's topic, that is reconnecting communication. See, we have different types of relationships with people. Firstly, of course, the behavioral scientists tell us that there are approximately three types of our social circles. One is the intimate circle. That would be my parent, my spouse, my child, maybe my sibling, with whom I'm very intimate, very close, and I feel, you know, no inhibitions, and I feel that this is like a permanent relationship. Although I keep cautioning people that there is no such thing as a permanent relationship in life. I'll come to that in a minute. Beyond that intimate circle is what we call as close circle. You may have a best friend, you may have a neighbor with whom you connect very well, you may have a cousin, you may have somebody who has been your classmate long back and now you still continue to, you know, enjoy the long-term relationship from your childhood onwards. These are people whom we would define as close relationships. And beyond that are our external relationship. You may be having a friendly neighborhood shopkeeper. You may be having a domestic assistant. You may be having colleagues in the office. All these people with whom you interact with. So these are the three circles in which we have got relationships. Now, whether you like it or not, relationships can break in any of these three categories. The outer circle, if you have known somebody, like I said, you may be having a, you know, friendly shopkeeper, and then you realize that he's overcharging you, or he's being very grumpy, or he doesn't open the shop on time. So you move on to somebody else and you say that, okay, now let me forget this fellow, and you have nothing to do with him. Even if you go that side, you just pass by the shop without even saying hi to him. It's okay, nothing happens. So in most of these, you know, outer circle relationships, if they break, it doesn't really concern us. But here again, I would like to say that if you have known somebody even in the outer circle and the communication has broken, you need to introspect. Do I need to rebuild communication with this person? Is it to my advantage to cover back again? Maybe I had some small experience because of which I stopped communicating. But you cannot deny that you had communication. You had some sort of a relationship with that person for quite some time. Why do I want to give up that investment in people? Then when we come to the close circle, it becomes even more important. You have a classmate or friend or a colleague and something goes wrong. You don't like that person or that person doesn't like you. And you decide that, no, I don't want to communicate with this person. And of course, if it is in the intimate circle, it can be very, very hurtful. If you have somebody whom you considered your own, somebody whom you trusted, somebody with whom you had a very close, very warm and a very trustworthy relationship, if that breaks and you stop communicating, you stop talking to each other, it can hurt very badly. So today we are here to discuss what can be done about it. So whenever a communication breaks or a relationship breaks, I would like you to seriously think that, would you like to be very rigid and say, nothing doing, I don't want to have anything to do with this person? It's your right. You have a choice. And the same thing if the other person says, I don't want to have anything to do with you. I'm upset with you or I'm angry with you or whatever it is. And you say, so be it. I will also not have anything to do with you. Now, if you do that, my humble request is, you have a right. Go ahead, cut off. Take some time. Interact with all your other people who are nice to you. Continue with your life for some time. After many days have gone past, just ask yourself this question. Would I like to reconnect my communication with this person? Because every relationship is an investment. It's like you have invested in some share, some chit fund, some property or whatever it is, and it has let you down. It's not getting you the profit. Would you like to completely cut off from that investment? Or would you like to still take a chance to get back something from that investment? The same thing you can do with regard to relationships. I have been telling this and I repeat again. There is no other single factor which determines your well-being, your happiness, your fulfillment as good, warm relationships. And relationships are built on a foundation which is called communication. If you're not communicating with somebody, it's as good as not having a relationship with that somebody. And this includes people with whom you have been very close earlier. And you drifted apart. It's not that you had a fight or you had differences or you said, no, I don't want to talk to this person. It's just that you drifted apart. There was a nice neighbor with whom you used to have very nice times. You learned something from him or her. You've spent some quality time and that person moves away or you move away. Would you like to give up on that? Or would you like to reconnect with that person? You may not be able to go for walks with that person as you used to do because the person was your neighbor, but you can catch up on the phone. You can talk to the person. You can make a visit one odd time or invite that person over if there's some occasion to invite. So these are all the factors which we talk about when you want to reconnect. And like I said, unless the person has been really horrible to you, and your mind just does not allow you to have anything to do with that person. Those are very extreme cases, right? It is only in those extreme cases that you are justified in saying, it's better I have nothing to do with this person. this person's character or morality itself is wrong. This person has hurt me in a number of times. This person's temperament itself is such that it pains me whenever I communicate with this person. Only those extreme cases, it is worth completely cutting off and not having anything to do with that person, right? But if you were to really introspect and think coolly, calmly, and that too, like I said, after many days have gone past and you have not had communication with the person, would I like to reconnect with this person? So before we talk about reconnecting, let's also talk about what are the communication barriers. What holds us back from communication? I jotted down a few points and I gave it to Anis this morning, and she has quickly made it into a nice little PPT by which you can see what are the communication barriers and how you can reconnect in if you feel like reconnecting. How do you overcome those barriers? So here are a few. It could be perceptual and language differences. You speak in a very, very soft and a very respectful tone. The other person is brash. The other person uses unparliamentary words and you don't like it. So that is the reason why you have disconnected. Similarly, there's this thing called information overload. This person just talks and talks and talks. Doesn't allow you to respond, doesn't allow you to react, doesn't allow you to give your viewpoints. At some point you say, no, I don't want to have anything to do. That's another barrier that can, you know, come in. Inattention, where either you or the other person is only hearing but not listening. I see two people sitting opposite to each other. One person is talking, the other person picks up the phone and starts messaging or starts taking a call which has come from outside. And tell the person, no, I'm listening to you. You go ahead. No, you're not listening. You're only hearing. The other aspect of when we talk about communication barriers, there are many, many, many of them. But what we need to do is to understand how to recover from the communication breakdown. This is something I would sincerely like you to introspect. Even if you have been hurt, you have been cheated, you have been let down, remember, it's in your interest to maintain, to nurture, and to develop relationships which give you the warmth, the feeling of being wanted, and which, as I said, helps in good relationships, which inevitably lead to a better quality of life. So let's talk about how you recover from communication breakdown. The first thing to understand is that when there is a difference, when there is an argument, when there is something, a conflict situation, try to focus on people and not arguments. If you win the argument to prove who's wrong, you lose a person and you just lose. Because what have you gained by proving a point that I am right and you are wrong? You've lost the person, isn't it? At times, learn to win the person and not win the argument. You have to suppress your ego. You have to tell yourself that it's not very important for me to prove that I am right and the other person is wrong. This is hard. It is difficult, I acknowledge. But if you develop the patience to be able to do that, if you practice it over a period of time, it becomes second nature to you. Then you realize that, yes, I would rather have the friendship and the warmth and a good communication with the person rather than take up an issue, battle it out, and try to win the argument with that person. The next. Yes. After that, how do you recover from a communication breakdown? The next one. No, it's not coming on my screen. That's why. Be patient. It is hard. After that. this slide is there, you have to communicate with technology also. You know, sometimes it's more difficult for me to communicate with technology than with human beings. This is something that I have learned. So Anis has made this, but the computer refused for a minute or so to put it up. What was it? Apologize and take responsibility wherever it is. Even if you feel that you are mostly right, it's okay. I was partially wrong. I don't mind apologizing. Apology is such a wonderful thing, you know. It builds such warm relationships. And apology doesn't necessarily mean that I am wrong. Apology is to say that you are important to me. If I've hurt you, if I've upset you, that was not my intention. Hence, I am saying sorry to you. Let's continue. Leave this issue aside and let us continue. And to be able to do that, you need to communicate clearly and respectfully. Many people, when they get into a close relationship, like I said, the intimate or the very close relationship, we stop respecting them. We take them for granted. We don't give them the basic courtesies that we give to people who are in our outer circle. We take them for granted in many, many, many ways. And we do not communicate clearly, thinking that he should understand what I'm trying to say. He knows me so well, or he is so close to me. No, there's no harm in communicating again. And how do you know that the communication has reached the person? Seek feedback. Have you understood this? Have I made myself clear? Do you, and you know, accept this type of information? Even if you don't agree with me, can we agree to disagree? And how can we improve on this matter? And on that, you have to follow up and follow through. Sometimes what happens is that you come across some sort of disagreement or differences in views, and you may even say sorry, you may say, yeah, we'll sort it out, something, and we let go. Both the people who have separated out, their thinking process starts and they start thinking negatively. So if you learn to follow up and learn to move on, maybe send them a nice polite message, maybe inquire with them on some occasion, maybe give them a small gift of something or the other. That is what I mean by saying follow up and follow through. Those are gestures which are telling the people that I care for you. I'm not letting things go just because you have and I have had a disagreement. That brings us to the most important, the last point would be the tips for improving communication. Once you have decided that I want to reconnect, or even a relationship which has developed certain cracks here and there or certain unpleasantness, why don't we make a continuous process out of improving the communication? Even if it's already there, it doesn't matter. Every relationship, according to me, has to be nurtured. And one of the most important ways of nurturing it is to have good communication. And good communication, as you can see in the first point itself, which I have written down here, practice active listening. According to me, communication is most important aspect of communication is to listen. To listen without interruption, even if you disagree. To listen till the other person completes. Maybe even ask permission. Can I say something about what I feel about this? When you ask permission, it is very difficult for the other person to get negative towards you. You interrupt and the other person also starts interrupting you. Then it becomes a ping pong battle in your communication. You are trying to tell something, that person is trying to tell something, neither of them listens. And one good way to convey difference is to use what we call as I statements. I was upset because of what you did. I felt that this is not the right way. I am thinking that maybe I have made a mistake. The more you use you statements, it is an attack on the other person, and the other person feels compelled to react, to throw things back at you verbally. But try it out and see if you communicate mostly with I statements. I am upset. I tell this even to parents who are interacting with their child. Instead of saying, you're a horrible child, you did this, you did that, tell the child, I am disappointed that you did not study. I am upset that you used a bad word. I feel very sad when I see that, you know, you are not treating your sister properly. So the more you keep using I statements, the better are the chances that your communication improves and your relationship improves. Now, when I said practice active listening, please remember that listening is not restricted to words. In fact, it has been proven that nonverbal communication is 55% of the total communication, the majority of it. And 38% is the tone in which you say it. So become a good observer. Pay attention to nonverbal communication. Pay attention to what the person is saying without using words. You will learn so much. Wherever you find a positive demeanor, wherever you see a smile on the person's face, wherever you see a show of concern towards you, acknowledge it. Express it in whatever ways you want. It could be something as simple as, you know, offering a glass of water or offering a tissue to somebody. And at all times, I request you, please be open to compromise. How important is it to always prove yourself right? Many a time it helps to compromise and say, maybe I don't agree 100% with you, but I'm trying to see your viewpoint. Okay, let's try this out, since you are very, you know, insistent, or you're convinced that this is the way it should be, or that this is what you have done is right. Let's try a compromise on that. And that can only be done if you avoid criticism and blame. The moment you start criticizing and blaming the other person, it's the reverse of what I told you about I statements. You have done this. You raised your voice. You ignored me. You didn't bother to call me when I was sick. Anything like that is contraindicated. It just, you know, brings the communication and the relationship down. If you avoid all forms of criticism and blaming the other person, stick to the issues. Never comment on the person. You are a liar. Can destroy a relationship. But I don't agree with what you have said. Maybe you have got wrong inputs, but what you have said, I felt, is not the right thing, and therefore I'd like to discuss this with you. See the difference? It will go a long way in improving your communication and relationship. And of course, be open to feedback. Whenever you have said something, ask the person, what do you feel about it? Every time you give a point of view, you can and should ask the person, what do you feel about this? Get a feedback. Tell the person to, because that person may not agree. That person may be upset. The person may be hurt. But if you are going on talking, what will happen? The other person will internalize it and quietly walk away from that interaction and not want to communicate with you. This can happen in any relationship, from the closest and most intimate to any of your outer circle. So please make it a habit. Whenever you believe in something strongly, whenever you feel that you have given a viewpoint which you are convinced about, at the end of it, stop and ask the other person, what is your opinion on it? And when that person gives you feedback, remember what I told you, do not interrupt. Even if you feel that person is saying something which is totally wrong, and you have evidence to show that your viewpoint is correct, wait till the person completes the feedback. At the end of it, if you have something that you agree on, even 10%, you say, yes, that particular issue, I agree with you. I think what you said about that is in consonance with what I think about it. I would like to tell you about certain things where I have a different viewpoint, and this is what I feel. Once you do that, the last point, and a very important point, is in every relationship, in every communication, learn to set boundaries. If you have a habit of, let's say, using unparliamentary words or cracking jokes at somebody's expense, and that person doesn't like it, introspect on it and set a boundary. I have other friends at whose expense I can crack a joke and they laugh with me. But this person is a very sensitive person. He's a very self-respecting person. So if I make the mistake of cracking jokes at his expense or using words which he doesn't like, the person is going to be upset. And remember, boundaries can be set both ways. You can also tell the person, I don't like to interact on this plane. I get upset if somebody uses, you know, slang words or something. It puts me down and I can't really interact very closely or very well with that person. So setting boundaries has to be done in both ways. Number one, you set boundaries for yourself before you tell the other person. You set boundaries for yourself and you start taking cognizance. If possible, tell him also, I know you're a very self-respecting person. I know that you don't like it when somebody speaks very loudly. I have this habit, you know, of speaking loudly. But in your case, I have taken cognizance of it. And I feel that maybe I should control myself. Maybe I should not impose on you just because you're my neighbor. I felt that, you know, it's not nice of me to walk in anytime. To first take your permission or inform you that I'm coming and then come. So I will practice that. In case you feel that I'm doing something which is not okay, please let me know. That is the feedback that I spoke about. And once you have done that and the other person is taken cognizance and is improved by it, then you have a right to set boundaries for the other person. When I am doing this, you know, I like to go jogging in the morning. If somebody comes and stops me and starts talking to me, I get a little disturbed because I like to finish X minutes of jogging or this so many rounds of this thing. And I concentrate on that. I do like to talk to all of you, including you, but not at the time when I am jogging. Or I feel that I should not be interrupted when I am talking to my children. I don't like the idea if somebody tries to impose something on my children because I'm very sensitive to the needs of my children. You can tell me, but preferably please avoid telling my child something like that. So once you set boundaries for yourself and you start practicing it, you develop the right to ask the other person also to follow boundaries. And only in the extreme case, like I told you earlier, the person is consistently upsetting you and not respecting you, then you are forgiven if you want to disconnect from that person. So that is the message I wanted to give you. I'll take a quick break, and today Purnima is here to talk to you. I'm sure she has some interesting things to tell you. I'll be back in a minute.
Am I live? Good afternoon. So, I was just thinking, last week, you know, at this time, we were all ready and up and about set for our DCS 24, which was the Silver Jubilee batch, the valedictory. So now valedictory is the last common class which we have year after year. So it's usually in the first week of April. That is from 2:30 to 5:30. Then from 10 to 1 o'clock, we had the special educators seminar. And it was too chock-a-block. But believe me, all of us had that thing that, okay, all this is there, but abhi life kaha hai, 2 to 3. We were so tuned to the idea, you know, of coming to the studio, starting the FB Live, and then checking whether we have sent reminders, notifications to all. So all that kept happening last week, and we missed, being with you during the talk session. And it's nice to come back. Yes, good afternoon to all of y'all, lovely people. Happy, happy, happy good afternoon to each one of you. And it's good to receive these, kind gestures and pleasantries from you. And summer is hitting us so much this year. There was one nice joke, like a meme or whatever you call it, that had come up, which was like, I think this summer must be very, very educated. Okay, means ye jo garmi hai, ye bahut padhi likhi hogi. Kyunki itna degree leke ghumti hai. So when I read that, I felt, oh, that was such a fantastic way of expressing that summer is at its hilt this year, and we all are desperately waiting for rains and or at least some breeze to come in, or the summer to go down a little. That was a very cute one. That thank you, Kanupriya. So that was about summer, and that was about our valedictory, which was there, and it was a fantastic day to see the students come. They performed, and it was a very touching moment. So one batch goes out, the second batch comes in, and it was very nice. Some of the students, Purni, we are not coming to the classes. Are you all missing us? I said, of course we miss you. Why would we not? Okay, are you missing anyone in specific? Or are you missing a team in specific? Or are you missing a batch in specific? That was like such a cute question they asked, because they wanted to know whether we were missing. We do miss our students. And when anybody drops in, it is such a lovely, nice moment, to meet them, greet them, have a cup of tea, get an update from them and give them updates. Yes, of course, our DCS 25 registrations have begun. We have quite a few registrations coming in and quite a few inquiries coming in. But that surely does not mean that, we say, okay, fine, DCS 24, 23, over, gone. No, each one is a very important, integral part of our family. And it is a cherished moment when they come to the academy and we meet them, sometimes with their family members, with their good friends, aunts, or someone like that. So that's how the way it goes over here. And I'm sure you're going to have a lot of questions coming up. Kaise karu, reconnect karu, nahi karu, communicate karu, why should I talk, why should that person not talk? Ask all your questions, because the person who is going to answer you, Ali, is here, and your questions and his answers. Bye, I'll see you soon. Ciao.
Just to set the record straight, it is not just your questions and Ali's answers, because Ali is not some antaryami or a guru who keeps giving answers to everything and keeps saying, you are you and I am I and all that. No. What I enjoy is your comments, your points of view. And I add on to that. I supplement it. And I bring my experiences and experiences of thousands of people who have, you know, spoken to me over years and decades. I just met a very interesting young man who passed out of IIT recently and has taken up a techie job in Bangalore. And he said that I want to, you know, get into the field of counseling. And I was reminded that I was in the same position almost 50 years back. And it's so nice, so overwhelming to see a very successful, a very competent and well-earning young man, you know, moving towards human welfare. These are the things that give us joys. So I've seen quite a few comments on the chat box already. Let me see how many I can respond to within the time limit. After all the hellos and how are yous, and specifically to hi Purnima's and all that. And Purnima is P-U-R-N-I-M-A. She is always points that out because she says, I'm not Purnima, I'm Purnima. Anyway, Vinita's comment, let us see that. She says, very true, Dr. Ali. I just read exactly something like this, that people try to win an argument, even with their friends or in workplaces, home, and eventually you do lose a relationship. Yes, this is such a subtle but a very grave reality which we need to be aware of. Keep it in mind. Akila says, oh, Akila is back after a long time. Welcome, Akila. Reconnecting should be the intention of both. If one doesn't want to continue the friendship and the other can't get over the same, another person stopped being friends as there was no gain in the personal or professional front. What do we do in this scenario? She's feeling betrayed and hurt. It was a friendship of many years. What I feel is, while I 100% agree with Akila that it has to be two-way, at the same time I feel that if I am convinced that I would like to reconnect with this person, I can still do a one-way communication. Starting with, let's take the intimate relationship. A spouse is angry and doesn't want to communicate. You ask a question and the other person grunts or refuses to reply or snaps back. Today, with technology being what it is, and even using yesterday's technology of simple things like post-it slips on which you can write and stick anywhere, open a communication which should not have a question mark at the end. Today is a cloudy day after many days of bright sunlight. That's it. You have communicated something to somebody who is not communicating with you, because that person is important to you. That person maybe lives in your own house or is closely connected with you. Why should I give up just because the other person has given up? I can periodically continue with these things. And that is only the written or the verbal communication. I can do communication gestures, which are totally non-verbal. I can buy a particular sweet which the other person likes and just keep it at a place which is his or her table or wardrobe. The message is very clear. You understood that this is my favorite sweet. You went out of the way and purchased it and kept it. You're not asking me, did I eat or did I like or did you throw it away? It takes patience, but it works. Right. Veena says, beautiful topic. Growing up in 80s and 90s, we were raised with mindset people. Relationship were more important than having our ways of winning. Yes, saying sorry was not considered weakness. Very true, Veena. But with social media and WhatsApp intervention, all the concepts of self-esteem and not being doormat is being introduced in our psyche, and where we are made to believe we should not give up our ways, rights, which is all confusing. But I guess we do need to note and recognize which relationships are important. Very well said, Veena. I agree with you. I'm often, you know, labeled as an anti-technology person. No, I'm not. I am a technology person. Like you have social people, anti-social people, and asocial people. I have a holiday. I like to spend it by myself. Thinking, reading, listening to music, writing something, sending messages to some important people whom I need to connect back to. But at the end of the day, somebody will say, how many people? Today was a holiday. How many people did you meet? I will say zero. But I was very happy with it. So that is what I mean by communication. That's why I took up this topic. It doesn't necessarily mean that you have to keep on sending forwards through WhatsApp or something throughout the day. It doesn't mean that you have to go and impose yourself on the other person. Veena also says, I learned wanting to be needed in relationship is a need and not weakness. Yes, I've always been emphasizing that any relationship comes with expectations. You cannot have a relationship if there's no expectation. If you keep giving money in charity to a beggar because he happens to be disabled, it's not a relationship with him. Every day you give him money for his survival, but you have zero expectation, which means there's no relationship with him. But if you like a neighbor, and when you find the neighbor has not cooked food and you give food to the person, or you cook a new dish which you feel that it's worth sharing and you do it, and if you want a relationship with the person, it comes with expectations. Once in a while, I would like that person to reciprocate, not necessarily by sending me food, because that person may not be into food, but it could be in other ways. It could be just checking on me when I'm not well. It could be giving me a lift when I don't have a vehicle. So expectations are part and parcel of any good relationship. Surekha says, how can we check in with the person to find out if he or she is in a good headspace to have a conversation about the fight? Like I mentioned, Surekha, make it one way. It could be a simple thing like, I felt bad that I said this to you. Full stop. No question mark, no asking anything. Give a gap. Again, mention something like that. Third time, say something else. Once you have laid the foundation, then you can start off by asking the person that, would you like to talk about it? I would like to talk about it. You are valuable to me. I want to reconnect with you, and give the freedom to the other person, whatever will be the response. Surekha also says the girl lost her trust in him due to a misunderstanding. Even after he explained, she just wasn't convinced. Should he give her time and continue being nice? Yes, Surekha. If the person values this relationship, if the person values this human being, it's okay. Allow her emotions to overflow at that time. Give sufficient gap, not one day, 2 days, or 1 week. When life has moved on and the other person has also accepted that you're not chasing her or trying to, you know, get close to her or whatever it is. Like I said, start with a one-way communication. He can just write something in general. After that, he can write something to her saying that, I was remembering the good time that we had when we had gone to that exhibition or that mall. Full stop. Over a period of time, see whether there is a hope or a chance that the person slowly starts reciprocating. Okay, Surekha. Yeah, this is already answered. Sunita says, yes, to save relationship many times, we need to keep silent and it works wonders. Yes, this is an excellent point you brought out, Sunita, that silence is a wonderful way of communication. The other person is upset. The other person is raising his voice or is losing the temper. If you can sit there, make eye contact with the person. Don't show your discomfort. Don't be ready to bounce back with your explanation. Relax. Be silent. I don't say it works all the time, but it works many, many times. Okay. Sneha says, what if we have parted ways and it's been so long And now there is doubts if the person wants to talk, what to do then? Comes back to the same thing, no, Sneha? Start a one-way communication. Firstly, very general. I'm happy that today we have clouds. That's it. Or my brother got his result and he has scored so many marks in the exam. Full stop. After that comes the second thing, that is, I still remember that particular movie which we had seen together. Or I remember that evening that we had spent and we had gone to the certain such place where they give very nice dosas. I was recalling that time with you. Full stop. You'll get your answers. Surekha also says, telling him how much you regret what happened, asking for a chance to explain yourself and validating his feelings will help us reconnect after a misunderstanding. Yes. And this is what I was telling you, that you start off by saying how I am feeling regret. I am feeling bad. That's why I keep emphasizing on this aspect of I statements. That helps the person to open out and reciprocate or respond if he or she wants to. Vinita says, I also feel lack of communication only brings lot of misunderstandings unnecessarily, but still either it's due to ego or anything else, some of them don't take that first step. Yes. So tell yourself, I am not going to let my ego come in between. I'm not bothered about whether I'm right or wrong. I value human beings more than anything else. So I'm going to make this effort and I'm going to be patient. Giving sufficient time, I'm going to try again till I'm totally convinced that this person just does not want to respond to me. It will happen very rarely. Surekha says, communication breakdown leads to relationship breakup. Exactly, that's what I said some time back, that communication is a foundation for relationship. Any building of good relationship can stand only on good communication. It's the first pillar. Roshan says, in any relationship, patience, love, respect, warmth gives both a good feeling and continue to nurture no matter what. Yes, this is what I've been emphasizing, that every relationship, good or bad, needs to be nurtured. Never take a relationship for granted. This is my mother, this is my spouse, this is my child. So we are going to have a good relationship and good communication. It doesn't work that way. Shobha says, one person doesn't listen to me at all. If I talk to her, she will definitely go to higher officers or local MLA or any person with written complaint against me. What do I do, Ali? Yes. These are very serious cases, Shobha, and everybody else. If you have someone who is so dogmatic, so extremist, that when you talk to the person with good intention, that person writes out written complaints and tries to give it to some authorities or somebody who can trouble you. I think it is in your interest to keep far away from this person and give signals. Let the person know that I don't care for you. I don't need to talk to you. I don't need to ask favors. I don't need to communicate. I am complete within myself. I'm not doing anything. That doesn't give that other person a chance to complain because you've not said anything, you've not done anything to her. Be careful of such people whenever you come across such. Yasmin says, I learned the difference between sorry and apology. I can extend apologies, but need to say sorry for everything. A slight deviation, Yasmin. You don't have to say sorry for everything. For example, I tell a parent, you lose your temper and you shout and say miserable things to your child because your child has done something which you had cautioned, you had warned a number of times and still the child went ahead and did it. Now you lose your temper and you say nasty things. You apologize for having raised your voice. You apologize for the way in which you dealt with the situation. But make it very clear that I'm not sorry for having punished you for this or restricted you from that. because it's in your interest, it's in the interest of safety or whatever it is. So be very clear when you apologize, what are you apologizing for? Sharmila says, even after starting the one-way communication and there is no proper response, I think it's better to stop as self-respect matters a lot. Don't treat it as self-respect, Sharmila. Just say that for some reason this person doesn't want to communicate with me. I put in sufficient effort. I've given time. I've allowed the person to cool down. Then I've again started with a one-way communication. The person is maintaining total silence. In some cases, the person is even saying nasty things about me to others, like how Shobha said. Then yes, it's not a question of self-respect. It's a question of choices. You say, I have better people. I have people who love me, who care for me, who value me. I'd rather spend my time communicating with them rather than hitting my head against a stone wall. So there are so many such things on a day-to-day basis, if you see. And as usual, I have this bad habit of writing small, you know, books, workbooks, I would say, for every aspect. I've written one on communication also, various aspects of communication. Anybody interested, please get in touch with our office and with Tvenu or anyone. We can give you either a hard copy or a soft copy of that. And we have tried to keep them as reasonable as possible in terms of cost and also the number of pages, because people today don't have time to read huge, thick, fat books. So that's what we do. And we continue with our humble mission. We continue to communicate with you on every Saturday as far as possible. Some very good people like you log in, listen to the whole thing and benefit from it. Some people catch up later. Some people say, no, what has he got to say? I know much better than him. So be it. I'm happy. I don't look for numbers. Whoever, even if one person benefits from these sessions, I'm more than happy. So all my good wishes to you. I take leave and over to Anis.